good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
We are going to start rejoicing by singing our opening song, Open the Eyes of My Heart. If you all will please stand on up and let's give it a go.
And join in. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. One more. Being lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. You high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Whew. That was a little warmer upper. Getting those fingers moving. What we got next, JB? How about if we sing about our Jesus, who is mighty to save?
Mighty to save. Thank you. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Service when we get to pray together, and today you will see in front of us we have some special baby gowns. In a minute they're going to pray too. Oh, okay. So the children are going to stay with us for just a moment so that we all have time to pray on the baby gowns. Peekaboo. These baby gowns have been made by a group in our church called the Butterfly Stitches. And Butterfly Stitches makes these gowns for premature babies to wear home, but we also make them for babies, for parents whose babies have died. And so before we send them off to the hospital this week, we always like to bless them and pray over them before they are sent out. So I would like to invite anyone who would like to come up with me to pray on these gowns. I am a kind of a tactical prayer, so I like to be able to touch things when I'm praying over them, and some of you may be that way too. So if you would like to come on up, kids, if you want to come up. Now we need to know, friends, that we need to touch them gently. Touch them gently. Oh, good job. Good job, Lydia. Look how gentle she's touching them. And if you don't want to come up here up front with us this morning, if you will simply just extend a hand towards the gowns as we pray. We got a nice group up here. Y'all ready? Dear Lord, we come to you this morning with a very, very special request. Here in this holy place before us are these beautiful blessing gown sets that have been so lovingly crafted by people in our church. They have compassion upon families who have premature babies. They have compassion upon families who have lost their babies. God, we know that these babies who have died are already living peacefully with you in heaven. We know that you cradled them in your own arms and you helped guide them safely to you.
Of this we have no doubt. They are the ones who are truly blessed. But even with that knowledge, God, this is still so hard. We also ask that you bless the preemies that receive them. Touch them with your power and strength and help them to grow and to thrive. God, most of us cannot even imagine losing a child or the fear of having a baby born way too early. Most of us cannot imagine the grief, the emptiness, the heart-wrenching sorrow and worry. But what we can imagine is the love and the mercy that you have already given to these parents, the love and mercy that we also share, signified by these beautiful creations. God, may these gowns provide some sort of solace, some comfort to those who receive them. May they know, God, that every single stitch is a labor of love, a labor provided by people that they don't even know. We pray that this speaks volumes to who you are and to who we are in Christ. And I thank you, God, for the willingness of those who made these to serve others and to serve you and your holy church. Bless their hands as they continue to carry on this special mission of love. We love you, Lord, and we are thankful for your goodness and grace. And now we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
And what time is it?
What time is it now? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Let me tell you something. These people have been working so hard to provide worship, a worship experience for you today. And we have had a few train wrecks.
Several.
But God is good. And we know that God is filling in all the gaps, and we are so grateful to him for that. Why don't you let us know, JB, what are we singing next?
This song, I wanted to select it. It's... You know, the Lord knows how we are, what we are, where our failures and our shortcomings are. But because of his grace and the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ, we can come as we are. Come out of sadness. From wherever you've been, come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth have no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too far. Lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you. There's hope for the hopeless and all who have prayed. The table contains the grace. Rest for the weary, rest for the troubled. Earth has no sorrow that heaven has. lay down your burden, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. Lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's joy in the morning, oh sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Sing it with us. Lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too far. Lay down your heart, come as you are. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are.
Amen. Y'all rock.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, a neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine?
Ready, sing with me.
I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you, so let's make the most of this beautiful day. Beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please, won't you be my neighbor?
Watch anytime on the PBS.
Go going on there. Oh, it's gone now. Okay. Good job, whatever you did back there. What? I know, that was not planned. I should have had on a red sweater. Or I should have had one to put on. Oh, my goodness. I just love that this is a place where we can have fun in church. And that this is a place of grace, and that we are all so happy and excited to be here to praise and worship our God this morning, to hear a message, to love on each other, to fellowship together, and to have some really good donuts. They were good? So last week we talked about being neighborly. And that one of the things that keeps us from being neighborly as we could be is the barrier of time. Now, we know that Jesus wants us to love our neighbors. But the question is, what if Jesus really meant for us to love our actual neighbors? What if we could move from strangers to acquaintances to relationships, like real relationships with our neighbors? What else besides time might be keeping us from moving in that direction? Well, today there's a passage in the Gospel of Luke chapter 7 that I want to share with you. There are lots and lots and lots of different messages in this one passage.
But today, I want us to put on our neighboring glasses. So everybody do it with me. Put on your neighboring glasses, and we are going to see this scripture today from that perspective. So Jesus gets invited to a pastor's house. A Pharisee would have been considered what is a pastor today. The pastor, his name was Simon, had heard about this Jesus guy. He had heard him speak, and he was intrigued by Jesus, but he was also very skeptical. So he invites Jesus to his home for a banquet. Now, back in Jesus' day, when a banquet was provided, it wasn't like we usually do now. He didn't go out and rent a venue space. He didn't hold it in his formal dining room that he only used once or twice a year. Maybe that's just my house. Banquets in Jesus' day were very public. They were usually outside, like in a courtyard. And so people could just be walking by while the banquet was happening, and so it would be really easy for anybody to just wander in. So that's where the woman in our story comes in. Scripture says that a woman from the city who was a sinner being code word for prostitute, wandered into Simon's banquet. She also had heard Jesus speak, and she became enthralled and she became overwhelmed with love for this man. Well, she must have been taking a walk and passed by Simon's courtyard and saw Jesus there at that banquet. And she had a thought, I could go and sit at his feet. Better yet, I could go and I could kiss his feet. Now, kissing a feet in Jesus' day was the ultimate act of adoration. The scripture tells us that she stood behind Jesus at his feet and began to bathe his unwashed feet. Now, this is an important detail for a little bit later on in the story. She bathed his unwashed feet, drenching them with her tears, drying them with her hair, kissing his feet, and anointing them with ointment, or some say perfume. Either way, this ointment or perfume was most likely the most valuable thing that she owned. And as she was pouring out this ointment, she is pouring out her whole life in love and in gratitude for Jesus. So Simon, he's watching this whole thing unfold, but he doesn't actually see what is happening. In verse 39, Luke tells us that Simon thought to himself, if Jesus were the real deal, he would know what kind of woman she is. He would never let her do this, especially in public. All Simon knew was that this was making him feel very uncomfortable. And the woman was simply showing adoration for Jesus, but all Simon could see was a dirty prostitute who had no right to be there, much less messing with his guest. Now, Jesus does something really incredible, although I guess I shouldn't ever use the word incredible with Jesus, because Jesus was the most credible human being that ever walked the earth. But he did something crazy. He responds to Simon about what Simon was thinking. Now, I don't know about you, but this would kind of freak me out a little bit. Jesus is responding to what is in Simon's head. And he responds to him by telling this story. A certain money lender had two debtors. One owned 500 denarii and the other owed 50. And when they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. Now, which of them will love him more? So if we translate this into today's time, this parable might sound something like this. So both people were struggling with debt. Now, one of them was behind on his cell phone bill and a few other bills for some other stuff, and he had racked up a few thousand dollars on his bank credit card. The other guy, he had suffered a lot of misfortune, some of which he probably brought on himself. And over a long period of time, he had maxed out all his credit cards, his car had been repossessed, the bank was foreclosing on his house, and he owes the bank about $250,000. Neither one of them saw a way out. And then the president of the bank calls both of them and says, "Your debt is forgiven." Simon, which one would love him more? Which one would be filled with the most gratitude and relief and joy and love for the person who canceled the debt? Who is going to be changed the most? Well, Simon answers Jesus probably a little reluctantly because at this point he's beginning to see where Jesus is going with this. And he says, "Well, I suppose the one for whom he had canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly. You get a gold star, Simon." So until this point, the conversation has only been between Simon and Jesus. But now Jesus turns toward the woman and he asks Simon, "Simon, do you see this woman?" This is a very critical question. Simon, do you see this woman? Well, he didn't. Simon didn't see her. He didn't really see her. All he saw was somebody who was way beneath him, somebody who was just a lowly sinner. All he saw was someone that he would rather not have in his world, and somebody who didn't matter to him, society, or probably to God in his opinion. Jesus tells Simon, "I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet," which, by the way, was kind of a diss towards Jesus, because giving water for guests to wash their feet was an act of hospitality. And he says, "But she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her own hair." He said, "Simon, you gave me no kiss. You didn't even kiss my cheek like an equal would do, much less even kiss my hand like a student would kiss a rabbi's hand. But from the time she came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet." "Simon, you didn't anoint my head even with regular, normal, common olive oil. But she has anointed my feet with an expensive perfume or an expensive ointment. And it's the most valuable thing she has." We can learn so much from this one moment. Jesus' question to Simon is one that we all need to be wrestling with. Do we see what is really going on around us? Like, do we really see? Are we really present to the opportunities, to sacred, divine moments that are available to us all the time? Do we really see people the way that Jesus does? We need to learn how to really see people, friends. We need to strive to keep our eyes open in every sphere of our lives, including our neighborhoods. Friends, Bob and I live in Van Dyke Farms. It is a huge neighborhood, Every day I see people riding their bikes, and I see them playing tennis, and I see them walking their dogs, and they're working in their yards. But I haven't really seen them. I know nothing about them or their lives. Because each of us has like this filter inside, like Simon, that allows us to just disengage from others. And we end up missing the point. There are a number of reasons why we fail to see people. Sometimes we're like what we talked about last week. We're just too busy. We are laser focused on our own little worlds. But sometimes we unconsciously label people. You know, think about it. We might see that person that lives across the street. You know, maybe you saw them doing something weird in their yard one day, and they're doing something strange, and they seem a little bit off to us, and we just say, you know, he's just an odd duck. That person makes me feel uncomfortable, like the woman did for Simon. And then we label him or her, and then we just detach. We just close that door and we just move on. And one of the reasons why we do this is because of fear. We don't actually want to see people because we're scared to. We live in this world where we have access to so many news stories every moment of every day. The media gives the details that are always the worst to hear, and they play them over and over again. And we're inundated with stories of pain and suffering. It's like watching Nancy Grace. How many of you ever watched Nancy Grace? If you've never seen it, don't ever look for it. It was she had a horrible, horrible show. I couldn't even manage to listen to the things that she talked about. Like, this stuff really happens in our world? I don't know about you, but sometimes I just have to turn the TV off. All these shows, so much access, so much awareness, it does something to us subconsciously. They make us think the worst of the unknown. It makes us believe the worst in people. And friends, that is not at all what Jesus did. We say that we want to be like Jesus, but are we really doing it? And do we want to? Now, I'm not saying that we don't need to use discernment, because we absolutely do, but we cannot use fear as a crutch that we lean on way too much to give us a reason not to engage with others. Friends, we hear it in Scripture over and over again. If you don't do anything else, do this. Love God and what? Love your neighbor. I mean, think about, like Simon, the labels that you may have put on others, the assumptions that you have made. Oh, he's an odd duck. She's just a busybody. I'm not pointing at anybody specifically right now. Here, I'll point out here. He's kind of a grumpy old man. That person, a little creepy. Tattoos. That must be in trouble. Think about your assumptions. Think about your labels. Think about your fears and why you have them. And then ask God what He wants you to do. Am I supposed to move beyond this? Every day, friends, we make choices about whether or not we will go deeper with people around us. And our encounters with people every day could go one way or another. What we can choose to do, what we choose to do, can make a difference in our lives, but also in the lives of others. So Bob and I went to a church in Birmingham several years ago. What'd you say? It was like 15 years ago. And the pastor there was talking about something very similar. And he told a story about this guy in his congregation who had a neighbor. There were two families. Their kids played together. The guys coached their sports teams together. They played golf together, but never on Sunday, because on Sunday, one of them went to church. These guys, they had a great relationship, or so this man thought. And he told the pastor, he said, you know, one day they were over at my house. We were having a barbecue. We were standing in front of the grill. We're flipping burgers and making veggies, maybe a little bit of sausage and, you know, anybody hungry yet? Cooking on the grill, and they're just standing there cooking and they're talking. And he said, all of a sudden, my friend asked me, he said, we're friends, aren't we? And he said, I told him, I said, well, yeah, of course we're friends. We play golf together. Our families hang out together. Why do you ask? And he said, he says to me, well, we must not be as good friends as I thought. If we're such good friends, why have you never invited me to church? Aren't I a good enough friend that you would want me to spend eternity with you in heaven someday? Now, that guy had made some assumptions. Well, he's just a neighbor. I mean, he knows I go to church, so if he wanted to come to my church, he would ask me about it. Or he has never talked about God, so he must not be a believer, so he won't want to come to church with me. Or even worse, he's my golf buddy, and if I ask him to come to my church, I'm afraid I'll offend him, and if I offend him, he won't be my golf buddy anymore. That would be terrible. How easy, friends, would it have been for the guy just to ask his neighbor to go to church with him? They already had a relationship. But what about those with which we don't have a relationship yet? Maybe they're still strangers. Maybe they're acquaintances. But you have yet to take that next step to be in a real relationship. So what should you do? Well, we should listen to the Lord. If you only do one thing, do this. Love God with everything that you have and love your neighbor as yourself. This is the main thing. If you fail to do this, you will miss out. You'll miss out on living life the way God has always planned for you. The kind of life that Jesus has already modeled for us, and Jesus expects us to follow his model. And this is the kind of life that Jesus has in store for you. Friends, it is so tempting to look at that passage and say, I just want to define neighbor the way I want to. Whatever way is easiest and doesn't make me feel uncomfortable. It is so dangerous to turn this commandment into a metaphor. And this is the reason why we hear it over and over and over again. This is so foundational to what it means to follow Jesus. When you can do this well, everything else will fall into place. It will change everything around you, and it will change you. In a few minutes, Rosie's going to share a song with us, and some of the lyrics say, what if I give all? This is part of the all. It says a gift like this could change the world. It is hard. And it can be messy, but so worth it. Friends, I encourage you during this Advent and Christmas season and beyond, take baby steps. Start with little things. Learn a name. Take a plate of cookies with an invitation to Christmas and to Advent and Christmas services, which you will be getting next week. We are expecting everyone to take some. If you're afraid to hand it to somebody, just tape it on the top of the box of the plate of cookies and go like this. May you take those labels off of people and start seeing them how God sees them. May God remove your fear and continue to be with you as you continue keeping the main thing, the main thing. Let us pray. God, we want to make the main thing the main thing. We want to do as you have called us to do. In the last service, we sang five verses of the song, "We Love to Tell the Story." We say that we love to tell the story, and then we're afraid to tell it. So God, I ask that you give us strength and courage to do the right thing, to keep you in focus. God, especially now this weekend as we celebrate Thanksgiving, as we run around like crazy people cooking turkey and making stuffing and vegetables and pumpkin pie, may we stop and remember the main thing, and that is to love you with everything that we have. And to love our neighbors like you love them. We are grateful, God, for your example. We ask that you help us to follow it. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Kathy. As we prepare to take our offering, remember if you've done an hour's worth of service outside of the church this week to put in a salty service card and... We will do the offering prayer. Great and glorious Savior, we listen attentive to your voice. We place our trust in your truth and grace. We generously give in gratitude for your truth in our spiritual journey. We pray that these monetary gifts may help others to see your kingdom, to draw you closer to us, and to find ultimate peace. We pray in the name of the one who sustains us throughout life's journey, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Amen.
Rosie. So I got just a couple of announcements before we have our closing song. First of all, Thanksgiving week this week. The office will be open Monday and Tuesday, but we will close on noon on Wednesday and won't be open again until next week. So if you need anything from the office, do it quick. Nettie is going to be decorating for Christmas tomorrow. She's looking for some people to join her team. If you've got an hour, if you've got the day, come on over. What time, Nettie? 9 a.m. tomorrow morning. Anybody like to decorate for Christmas? Oh, there you go. There's your people. We've got the angel tree back there in the back. Last week, all the tags went like zippity-doo-dah. And so, but now we have made requests of our food pantry families. And we have added tags this week for 70 children on our Christmas trees. And so we have lots of new tags. So if you didn't have an opportunity to get one last week, go take a look after church today. Pick one or 10, because there's a lot of them. And bless a child for Christmas. Also, we still have our Zoe Empowers Christmas cards and Christmas decorations out there, as well as the silent auction going on for the baskets for Zoe, and also the Crafty Ladies have their silent auction still going on to raise money for local missions. These silent auctions will take place until the 15th of December, or maybe we say the 14th, because we're going to announce the winners on the 15th at the potluck after our cantata. There will be one service that day on the 15th. Am I forgetting anything? Anybody? Going once, going twice? Well, so one of the things that I asked JB is if he would share with you why he chose the songs that he chose for today. If you don't know, it's Cap and Lynn's 10th anniversary, so they are on a trip this week, this weekend to Orlando. So when you see them, make sure you say happy anniversary. And so I asked him about this last one that we're going to do. It's called Glory, Glory. And it's by David Crowder, which we already sang a David Crowder song earlier. And I said, so this is the reason why I think JB picked this song, because he loves David Crowder.
And he's from Texas also.
And we want to give glory to God, don't we, in everything that we do and say and think. And so this is a great reminder for all of us, if you will please stand.
All right, let everybody sing out. It's probably one that I'm pretty sure we haven't done yet here, so it's got a real catchy tune, and it's a good one, so let it rip. Well, glory, glory, I've been singing since I laid my burden down. Glory, glory, I've been singing since I laid my burden down. I'm singing hallelujah, God is able, hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. Lord, I'm gonna sing. Well, I feel better, so much better, since I laid my burden down. I feel better, so much better, since I laid my burden down. I'm singing hallelujah, God is able, hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. Lord, I'm gonna sing. Well, as long as I'm alive, there's gonna be praising. As long as I'm alive, there's gonna be shouting. One thing that I know, oh yeah, deep down in my soul, as long as I'm alive, I'm gonna sing. I'm singing hallelujah, God is able, hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. Lord, I'm gonna sing one more time. I'm singing hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. Lord, I'm gonna sing.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, courage, strength, gratitude, and everything that the Lord gives. Amen.
I'm singing hallelujah. Lord is able, hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. Lord, I'm gonna sing. I'm singing hallelujah. God is able, hallelujah. God is faithful, hallelujah. Lord, I'm gonna sing.